Welcome to Ideas in Action, the official University of Southern California podcast. This show was recorded live on USC's campus.
Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming to the second of our weekly online Dornsife Dialogue series. This series was created in order to be able to extend to our entire Dornsife community an invitation to hear from our outstanding scholars, writers, and thinkers about the kinds of issues that we are all facing today in our lives and our communities. Today, we're going to talk about issues that families around the world are grappling with. How do we continue to do our jobs, attend our classes, while at the same time homeschool our children and mind our toddlers? And how, through all of that, do we make sure that our children are getting what they need to stay happy and healthy and continue to learn and develop? Today's discussion is going to feature experts from our newly launched USC Dornsife Center for the Changing Family. And without further ado, it is my pleasure to introduce you to its director, psychology professor Darby Saxbe, who is going to introduce the rest of the panel and guide the conversation. Professor Saxbe studies how family dynamics affect both the biology and the psychology of the family members within the family. And she has received a number of impressive awards, including the prestigious NSF Career Award for Young Investigators. She is frequently featured in the media. We've seen her in the New York Times, the LA Times, NPR, KPCC, among other places. And we are lucky to have her with us here today. So Professor Saxbe, the floor is yours.
Wonderful. Thank you so much for that very kind introduction. And I just want to welcome everyone to this event today and to acknowledge that, you know, everybody who's tuning in is affected by this pandemic in one way or another, whether we're experiencing loss or grief or fear, anxiety, economic worry, or just the stress of trying to balance too many obligations, right? We're all experiencing this really unprecedented and unique event. And moments of crisis give us the opportunity to kind of pull back the veil and expose our vulnerabilities as individuals, as families, as a society. So today we have an amazing panel with expertise in mental health as well as in law and society. And we're going to range from sort of advice and help for individual families to how we can be more resilient as a society and in our communities to some of the challenges that are facing families. So I want to have the panel introduce themselves. People are going to say their name, their affiliation, a little bit about the work they do, and then tell us how they're affected by the pandemic, and then we'll open up the conversation. So let's start with Dorian Traube.
Hi, I'm Dorian Traube. I am an associate professor in the USC School of Social Work, and my research primarily focuses on families with really young children before the age of five, and focusing on how we can help families promote their children's development and make sure that they enter school ready to learn, with the idea that parents are their child's first and most influential teacher. And I spend a lot of time focusing on how we can do that work using things like distance technology to make it easier for families to access services. And I am personally impacted by this pandemic because I am now not only doing this work, but also providing crisis schooling to a first grader and a fourth grader in both English and Korean. And I am not a Korean speaker. So it is definitely challenging.
All right. Amy West.
Hi, everyone. My name is Amy West. I am a clinical psychologist. And an associate professor in the Department of Pediatrics at Children's Hospital Los Angeles and the USC Keck School of Medicine. My specialty is in the treatment of mood and anxiety disorders in children and adolescents, and in developing and studying interventions that help parents and families function as effectively as they can when a child and their family is impacted by either a mood or anxiety disorder. In terms of kind of the personal impact of this pandemic and quarantine, I also, like so many people, I'm a parent. I have a 9-month-old infant and a 4-year-old. And I am, you know, now 100% working from home full time. They're also home. And so just, you know, really struggling, I think, like everybody else, to try to kind of maintain boundaries and figure out new routines and try to still maintain some semblance of separation between my work and family life, and just trying to kind of be as flexible as I can and go with the flow. Very happy to be here.
All right, Clare.
Hello, everyone. Hello, everyone. I'm Clare Pastore. I'm professor of the practice of law at USC Gould. I'm also a practicing attorney. I focus on issues of poverty, inequality, and access to justice, much of that in continuing to litigate actual cases with students, and also in terms of teaching about civil rights, poverty in the law, government accountability. In terms of how I am personally affected by this, I'm happy to report that our 4 kids who are all adults are all still employed, but we worry about the 2 who are in their first jobs and whether those jobs will last. And we worry about the 1 who's scheduled to get married in May and whether any of us can be there.
Okay, Marian Williams.
Hi, I'm Marian Williams. I'm a clinical psychologist based at Children's Hospital Los Angeles and an associate professor in the Keck School of Medicine. I run an infant mental health program where we work with families who have children ages birth to 5. Our program includes babies who have a medical condition and are hospitalized in the neonatal intensive care unit, young children who are involved in the child welfare system, children who have developmental delays and disabilities. And personally, I'm sheltering at home with my adult sons while also trying to work full time, supporting my team in their transition to telemental health. And one of the personal challenges that I'm facing is just not being able to hug my mom, even though she lives only a few miles away from me in an independent living facility, but no visitors allowed.
Wow. Thank you, everyone. Yeah. And my personal impact is that I'm hiding from my family so that I can moderate this discussion. And as we were doing introductions, my 10-year-old started knocking on the window. So this is very real for all of us. So the faculty who are here today are all part of our new, as Amber Miller mentioned, Center for the Changing Family, which is an interdisciplinary group of faculty who study families from different methodological vantage points and at different stages along the lifespan. So I'm really excited to sort of have this expertise all together, not in one room, but at least in one virtual panel. So we're going to sort of have 3 main sections in our discussion today. We're going to start by talking about impact. How is this pandemic affecting families and mental health, especially the most vulnerable families? And then we're going to talk about solutions. What are some things that individual parents can do, that families can do to better manage this stress? And also, what are some policies and programs that can make us better equipped as a society? And then finally, we're going to talk about resilience. What can we learn from this pandemic that might make us more able to face future crises of this nature? So I encourage anybody who has a question, I'll be monitoring questions. We'll mostly be taking questions at the end, but please do use the Q&A feature. We'd love to sort of speak to some of your particular concerns. But I thought I'd start just by, Amy and Marian, you both are working clinically with families at Children's Hospital. What are some of the challenges that families are facing? What are you seeing in your practice right now? What are the concerns that clients are bringing to you?
Well, I think if I think about the infants and young children that we work with, the challenges that I'm hearing about seem to have kind of 2 themes: too much separation and too much togetherness, which probably a lot of us can relate to. I think when I think about separation, I'm hearing about, for example, a breastfeeding mom who is abruptly cut off from being able to visit her baby who's in foster care, or a family member, a baby who's hospitalized and only one family member can visit. And so there's a teen mom who cannot bring her mom with her when she goes to visit her baby in the hospital. you know, preschoolers who can't play with their friends. So I think those separations are really challenging. And then I think on the togetherness side, you know, we have families that are in overcrowded conditions with, you know, 13 people in a two-bedroom and nobody's going to school or work. And so they're all together all day long, which is really stressful. And I think about parents who were maybe already experiencing some conflict before, and now they're kind of sheltering at home and trying to work out those challenges, but without being able to get privacy from their children. And so everything's happening out in the open. So I think those are some of the challenges that I'm hearing about.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And so I work more so with kind of school-aged kids and adolescents. And there's a couple of themes that have kind of emerged in my work as well, my clinical work over the past couple of weeks to a month. I'd say one is that, you know, I think kids and adolescents are feeling some pretty big emotions in response to what's going on in the world, whether it be kind of, you know, frustration and anger about not being able to see friends and having to adjust to entirely new routines, lots of anxiety about just the unknown of kind of what their future is going to look like. And also some pretty significant kind of grief and loss around, you know, missed opportunities for, you know, in their lives. For example, I work with a couple of adolescents who are seniors in high school and are really grieving about not being able to, you know, be with their friends for the remainder of their senior year in high school and not being able to celebrate graduation and really kind of mark the transition from high school to college. And I think to them, that feels like a really significant loss and something that they're really mourning. In addition to that, I think, you know, for kids and adolescents who already have an anxiety or depressive disorder or who are particularly vulnerable to anxiety or depression, you know, I think the kind of chaos and uncertainty in the world is very triggering, can be very triggering. And so for a lot of my kids, like symptoms are coming back up and, you know, they're feeling more and more dysregulated. I think, you know, their own kind of intensified emotion coupled with the disruption and the routines in their lives. And so I think they and their families are really having to be creative and to think really carefully about establishing kind of new routines, new coping strategies, new ways of kind of providing some of the regulation for their kids that these external structures like schools and peers and other influences that aren't available anymore, you know, did provide for them. So I think that's another thing I've seen. And then finally, just lots and lots of stress in parents. I think, you know, parents are simultaneously having to balance work and childcare, in some cases schooling their children, all while kind of trying to keep the family life together and manage their own feelings of fear and sadness and overwhelm. And, you know, kind of trying to do all of that at a time when they feel immense pressure to keep everything together, you know, and to take care of their children and take care of their partnership and take care of their family life. And I just think that's a tremendous amount of pressure for parents to feel. And it's, you know, it's having its impact.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Yeah. And speaking of, you know, you talked about sort of clinically significant, you know, how this might be different in people with pre-existing mood or anxiety disorders. Dorian, you've also done a lot of clinical work. And I'm wondering if you can speak to, you know, how do we differentiate from just sort of kids' normal reactions to everything that's going on and parents' reactions to when do we know there's a problem that requires more kind of serious attention?
Yeah, I think we should be expecting all of us to be decompensating a little bit. Right. That's the adults, that's the kids, that's the babies in your house. So even thinking about things like sleep regression, if you've got your baby on a good schedule and they were able to put themselves to sleep when you laid them down in a crib and now all of a sudden they can't, that's normative in this environment. It seems odd, but those little teeny babies are picking up in on the complete change of environment and schedule that they may have had prior to these shelter in place orders. So I'm hearing lots of adults having difficulty sleeping. Your babies pick up on that, and that's okay. Like, don't panic about it. Don't beat yourself up about it. It's normative. But you're gonna see issues like this pop up through the age spectrum. And I think what we're looking for is how long those types of symptoms last. So if you have a very tearful child, and they're tearful a lot of the time, if they have a very low tolerance for frustration when previously they had a pretty standard tolerance for frustrating things, to keep an eye on that. And if it's lasting longer than you think it should, or if it's making it really challenging to operate on a day-to-day basis, that's when you should be reaching out either for some additional resources or some additional help for your family. There's plenty of strategies out there that can be utilized even when you're having a shelter in place. There are lots of options for interacting with experts on this through telehealth platforms. So there are experts out there, but even on your own, recognizing that it's okay to reduce some of the expectations that you might have for your child while things are super stressful. Because if they're school-aged all the way through high school, they're picking up on changes in their schedule too. They're having to learn new ways of learning. They're having to deal with the social isolation when they're really used to being around their peers. And they're probably suffering from lack of a physical outlet to run off their energy. Mm-hmm. So keeping all of that in mind, reducing the expectations that you have for your kids, creating diversions for them, and just being patient with one another.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And you know, we're already getting so many great questions that I'm monitoring. So keep those coming. But speaking about using some of these outlets and strategies, Clare, you've done work on families living in poverty who may have some disparities in whether they're able to access. They might have some disproportionate impacts. And I'm wondering if you can talk about how your work is intersecting with this pandemic.
Sure. I'd like to talk briefly about two things. One is what the pandemic is underscoring about inequality in our society. And I say underscoring rather than revealing, because most of this is not new. It's not new to anyone watching this webinar. It's not new to anyone participating in it. It's not new to anyone who lives in our country. We have obvious economic inequalities. We've all seen lots of information about the growth in income inequality in recent years. And that manifests in many ways that are truly frightening during the pandemic. So one is, of course, who has a cushion to fall back on if income drops? I suspect a lot of people saw the absolutely shocking number last year when the Federal Reserve found that 40% of Americans could not cover a $400 cash emergency if they had to. 40% of Americans did not have access to $400 in ready cash to cover an emergency if that was necessary. The Federal Home Loan Mortgage Company found in 2019 that Los Angeles is the third most rent-burdened city in the United States after Miami and San Diego. That doesn't mean the most expensive city. That means rent relative to income. But we are the third most rent-burdened city by virtue of that metric in the entire United States. A third of Angelenos are spending more than 50% of their income on rent. This is before the pandemic. Minimum wage earners, even with our state minimum wage, one of the highest in the nation at $14.25 an hour, that's under $30,000 a year. So it is very, very difficult for working poor families and families living in poverty to make it even before the pandemic. The pandemic is also underscoring health disparities. We need more data, but it appears from the early data that communities of color are being hit harder by the COVID-19 pandemic than others. Data was just released, a report went up on the LA Times 24 minutes ago that there's data out that in California, African Americans are 6% of the population, but 12% of the COVID-19 deaths so far. In Michigan, it's 14% of the population and 40% of the deaths. Some of this is because health conditions that compromise immune systems may be more prevalent for various reasons in different demographic groups. Some of it is differential access to care, which correlates by income, which correlates by race. And some may correlate with other factors, such as disproportionate representation of workers of color at the low end of the employment scale in jobs where they are continuing to come into contact contact with the public, whether that's as nurses' aides, hospital workers, grocery workers, et cetera. So there's a whole constellation of issues about income inequality and health inequality that we are now seeing in sharper focus than ever. We're also seeing things that certainly wouldn't be rocket science for anyone to think of, but we maybe didn't put our attention so clearly on them before, like inequalities of space and privacy. Who has a place in their home, like it appears that most of us on this webinar have, to go into a room, close out other family members, even if only for an hour, have relative quiet in the background, have a stable internet connection? All of those things are scarce commodities for people living in poverty. And then, of course, the digital divide itself, just the access to the technology that makes continuing any semblance of normal life possible during this time. Access to a computer, access to the internet, access to a stable internet connection, all of those things. So we've seen underscored things that are not surprising, but we're seeing them in a new light. One of the things that I think many people are realizing for the first time is what this pandemic reveals about how thin and tattered our social safety net is. The first fact is one that shocks many people. I talk about this with my poverty law students every year. There is no federal program in the United States that provides cash aid to people just because they're poor. That doesn't exist. Lots of people, lots of students, lots of workers are under the impression that the poverty line is some kind of magic number, and if you're under that line, you get something. And that is absolutely not the way the American system works. Our poverty alleviation programs are all based on poverty plus disability, poverty plus caring for young children, poverty plus working previously or currently or in some way. So we simply don't have a let's help people who need it because they're poor framework for our poverty programs. Second is that the poverty definition is so low. Officially, the poverty line for one person is about $13,000 a year. If you earn $13,010, you're not poor. Mm-hmm. That's shocking. For a family of three, the poverty line is less than $22,000 a year or about $1,800 a month. So if you earn $2,000 a month, you are not poor by the official metric. Long before the pandemic, there have been millions of Americans who are poor by any reasonable measure, but who don't count as poor in the way that we've set up our social systems. Now we're seeing incredible stress on the systems that are supposed to react in times of crisis. So everyone's probably seen the shocking figure, about 17 million unemployment claims in the last 3 weeks, the highest ever number since the system began as part of the Social Security Act of 1935. What many people don't know is that unemployment, just as I was mentioning earlier about sort of the lack of general programs, unemployment isn't for people who say, I don't have work. Unemployment is for people who were working in covered occupations, worked enough weeks and made enough money to now qualify. So there are millions of workers who are left out, and that skews disproportionately toward low-income workers, toward women, toward workers of color. Gig economy workers, by and large, are not eligible. Undocumented workers are not eligible. Many household and caregiving workers are not eligible. Mm-hmm. So we have massive holes in that unemployment system. The stimulus check, the stimulus checks just went out. One of my kids got their stimulus check today by direct deposit. That's 150 million payments of $1,200 each plus $500 per child under 17. That's coming through the tax system. So those who didn't file taxes in 2018 or 2019 are not going to get those checks without difficulty. I'll mention here that a couple of the legal services organizations that serve low-income people in California have put together a terrific fact sheet about the stimulus payment in English and in Spanish, and I'll make sure that by tomorrow that's posted on the Center for Changing Families website and on the Dornsife Dialogues website so people can get that info if they need it. But again, undocumented workers not eligible for the stimulus check. Those without Social Security numbers not eligible. Advocates have recently learned that many of those checks are being seized by debt collectors, because many low-income people owe debts and debt collectors are trying to swoop in and grab those payments. So it's certainly something. It's certainly better than nothing to have that, but we have big holes in terms of reaching the neediest folks. And the last thing I'll mention about the holes in the safety net for the moment is the welfare system. I mean, historically, when we talk about the welfare system, most people have in mind what used to be called Aid to Families with Dependent Children, or AFDC, Program for Single Moms and Kids. We don't have that anymore. We haven't had that since 1996. And the reason I mention that is because the changes in 1996 did several things that made welfare drastically unavailable in a time of urgent need now. We have a lifetime time limit. No adult can get federally funded welfare for more than 60 months, 5 years, in their entire life. No adult can get federally funded welfare for more than 60 months in their whole life. So many people have used up those benefits and they're not available now. Before the pandemic, welfare was only reaching 22% of those under the poverty line, down from 68% before those big 1996 changes. Today it's even fewer because so many people have used that up. So we're in urgent need of policy solutions to make our social safety net work better, not just in a pandemic, but to meet the needs of people living in poverty day in, day out.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah, and for those of you in clinical practice, how are some of these concerns translating into mental health effects on the families that you're serving? Yeah, Dorian.
So the programs that I work with generally have been delivered in the home to low-income families. And so there are a couple of losses that are happening. First is the loss of the service directly. So somebody can't come to your home anymore. It's not physically safe. Now there are replacements, right? We've moved to telehealth platforms. We can deliver it that way. But along with that comes the loss of the resources that the person, the provider could physically offer, like diapers, like wipes, like access to formula. And they often were supplementing what families could get through the Women, Infant, Child program, WIC. Because often WIC is not enough to get you over the hurdle when it comes to being able to feed your children. And WIC has never supplied families with diapers. And so that's a huge thing. So families are not only losing the social connections that they had with providers through that in-person interaction, but they're also losing some of those physical resources that they previously had access to. Mm-hmm. Add on to that, in schools, most schools have tried to develop a plan to be able to give children their free and reduced lunches, reduced cost lunches. However, what we see throughout Los Angeles are children who attend schools that are not close to their home necessarily. So it can be very hard for families to access those resources, even though they're being made available.
Amy.
Yeah, so I think, one of the things that I'm seeing working with a lot of these families who are very kind of underserved and have multiple psychosocial stressors, lack of access to resources, is I think these parents don't necessarily have the privilege to make the choices that we've been able to make. Like, they can't choose to work from home. They can't choose to be home with their children. They have to go to work if they're lucky enough to have a job. It's very often in industries for which they're not getting excused to work or able to work from home. So they're having to make these really difficult decisions about, you know, what does that mean? Do I leave my children home alone? Do I, try to find childcare that I can't really afford, which means somebody coming into my house or outsourcing my kids to relatives or friends, thus increasing their risk of getting exposed and, you know, sacrificing their health. So I think the kinds of decisions that, you know, come with these extra kind of psychosocial and socioeconomic stressors are really quite heart-wrenching for these parents, kind of on top of everything else, you know, that we're all dealing with, fear and anxiety and insecurity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I know, Marian, you've very quickly sort of supervised a ramping up of telehealth services at CHLA to reach a lot of the families that you work with, and it sounds like that's actually been going surprisingly well.
You know, it has, and I have to say, you know, despite all the stressors that we've been talking about, I think what's really hitting home for me recently is the successes that are happening. So the families that are kind of rising to the occasion and the appreciation that we've been getting from families when their therapist reaches out to them via phone or telehealth and offers them support and someone to listen to their struggles. So I think we've had some very creative therapists that are trying, you know, multimedia approaches, you know, movement, work with the children, even sending, you know, mailing materials to the house so that they can use them during therapy. And I think it's having an impact. And I wonder if we could, you know, I don't know if this is the time to talk a little bit about some of the solutions in terms of what what parents can be doing during this difficult time. Mm-hmm. But I know, you know, with, I was thinking about the, especially the young children that I work with, I think just getting the message out to parents that really their most important role right now is to connect emotionally with their children, to connect through building relationships, and to just forgive themselves that they're not their teacher, you know, that they don't have the skills, the training to be a teacher, and that's not their most important job, even though it might feel like that's what they're supposed to be doing. So I think if parents can kind of be forgiving of themselves on that front, and instead really focus on their own self-regulation. I always tell parents, if your child is getting out of control, having a tantrum, you know, being showing a lot of stress, step one is to tune into your own emotion regulation and to do whatever you need to do to calm yourself and feel together before you try to help your child. And I think if parents can focus on that and on making connections, creating moments of joy during the day, even if it's just one, that's what their children are going to remember the most later on. It's going to be that they had sort of a companion during this difficult journey, and that someone cared about them and was nurturing them through it, will stick with them a lot longer than the actual pandemic itself.
Yeah, Amy. So yeah, I mean, I really want to echo what Marian said. I think, one of the things that I've really been trying to emphasize with the parents that I work with is just to take the pressure off themselves. I mean, so many parents I know are trying to be the perfect parent, the perfect partner, the perfect teacher, the perfect friend to their kids, since their kids can't interact with their friends. And that's just way too much. And it's not possible. Those aren't their roles. It's not the role of a parent to be, you know, those things to their kids. So I think really just kind of, you know, releasing yourself from that, you know, desire to kind of be perfect in all of those roles, and just kind of focusing, you know, on more simple things like Marian pointed, just connecting, just communicating well with your kids. I think in having that be, at the center of kind of all of what you kind of try to do and the activities that you create and the systems that you create in your home. You know, I think also I've seen a lot of parents kind of trying to create these highly, you know, structured schedules that kind of mimic the schedule their child might be, engaging with if they were outside of quarantine. So filled with extracurriculars and hours of school and, you know, Zoom playdates with their friends. And I think it can just become too much. I mean, we can't have the same schedule in quarantine that we have outside of quarantine. So again, I think really just relaxing and scaling back. And I do think, you know, I do think it is important to initiate routines and structure in daily life, but not ones that try to mimic, you know, non-quarantine routines and structures. I think much more simplified routines. I think, you know, what I try to coach the parents I work with is, as long as you're, you know, encouraging your child to kind of move their body and exercise each day, get outside if you can, engage in some sort of relaxation and decompression, some sort of pleasurable activities. If schooling needs to be there for a couple hours, okay, schooling. And then just lots of time to connect with family in person, hopefully, for those you're quarantined with. And then, you know, some peer connection through virtual spaces to kind of maintain those friendships. But as long as you kind of have those basic things in place, I think that's enough. And parents should really release themselves from the pressure to kind of need to provide all these things for their children. And the last thing I'd say is that, putting my psychologist hat on, I think it's really important to give our children spaces to feel and to express their emotions, whatever they may be, about everything that's going on. And just to really, you know, have that be kind of a non-judgmental space where they can feel angry, where they can feel frustrated, where they can feel sad, and where they can feel fearful, and to focus on validating those feelings and on kind of approaching them with non-judgment and with compassion, and really trying to kind of understand and put yourself in your child's, you know, shoes and kind of take that perspective. And I think, you know, the tendency can be, I think, to kind of very quickly try to fix or distract, or you know, kind of suppress their emotion. And I think that's not, you don't need to do that. I think it's fine. You know, this is a very difficult time and your kids know it's a difficult time, no matter how old they are. They may have a, you know, differing level of understanding about it, depending on kind of where they are on the developmental spectrum, but they know that something is going on. And so I think you can be honest with them and real with them, obviously without sharing kind of the, you know, morbid and horrific details, but, you can have frank conversations with them and also don't be afraid to show your emotion. I think it's a wonderful opportunity in many ways to model for kids that it's okay to feel really hard emotions and to sit with that uncertainty and to kind of strengthen those skills of tolerating distress and to learn that we can kind of navigate that and we can come out on the other side. And that, you know, having the opportunity to practice that and to see parents doing that, I think is going to, you know, really improve their kind of self-regulation and skills and emotion regulation over time.
Our our family cat was looking very wistfully out the window this morning, and it was a really good opportunity to have a conversation about how we're all feeling, you know, really lonely and wish we could go outside right now. Claire, I see you have a comment, and then I'm going to shift gears and answer some or read some questions because we have some really great ones that have come in.
Great. Thanks. At the risk of being always the bearer of the bad news after following Amy's really helpful comments about things that people can do in their own families, I just wanted to mention that many of these issues of parental stress and, you know, sort of lower or higher level family dysfunction or the effects of stress on families are, of course, heightened for people living with material concerns and in small spaces as well. But I also just didn't want to let our panel go by without talking for a moment about kids in foster care and their families. We have 17,000 kids in foster care in Los Angeles County, one of the largest foster care systems in the nation. Before the pandemic, in a typical month, there would be about 13,000 calls and 900 emergency calls. The DCFS has reported, the Department of Children and Family Services, which handles this, has reported that there's about a 30% drop in calls since schools closed. Mm-hmm. That's likely because many, many calls, most of the calls that come to the hotline come from mandated reporters, people who are mandated by law to report suspicion of child abuse or neglect, and those are typically school teachers and other school workers and people in medical, who see children in medical capacity, and lots of those things aren't happening. So there's a concern on the one hand that there may be vulnerable children in dangerous situations without enough attention to that fact. And then on the other end, there's a huge concern that parents who need and deserve to get their children back from foster care are now having an enormously difficult time establishing that they've done what's necessary to do that. The courts, there are normally 25 courtrooms in Dependency Court in Los Angeles. Right now, there are only 7 open, and they're hearing the most urgent matters. So those emergency removals of kids from their homes and things like that. Reunification hearings, a parent who needs to come to court, show the judge, I've completed whatever it was, the parenting class, the drug program, whatever it was, those hearings are being put off into the fall and beyond. So I'm a little worried about the fabric of already vulnerable families in the system. And of course, the difficulties magnified by the digital divide and the difficulties of doing things like visitation between parents and children over some digital format, or does a monitor need to be in a room, a third person? How is that happening digitally? Yeah. How is a social worker ensuring, you know, that what's supposed to be happening is happening? So there's a whole bunch of very vulnerable kids and families that I think we also need to be attentive to.
Yeah, and I have to turn it over to Dorian because you've worked so much in that system and have really pioneered and innovated in the telehealth space particularly.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's widely documented that the child welfare system is really struggling under this because of the high risk of the families and children that are involved in it. And there were already imperfect protocols to begin with to investigate and support families in those situations. And so there's currently really, really strained under it. But definitely are technological options that can help child welfare, but also almost anybody to access interactions. And so, and I think we hear this a lot about adults having Zoom happy hours and kids having Zoom meetings with their classrooms. Those are all ways to try to replicate social connection. And then in terms of your health and your mental health, lots of telehealth options for families to tap into so that they can still get medical appointments, they can still get mental health appointments. I see a lot of chatter around parents having concerns that there might be something going on with their child, both physically and mentally, and not knowing what avenues to pursue. And I would say that you should still pick up the phone and call your providers, because they may have very quickly changed the way they're delivering services to you, and you don't even realize it, and you have options. And if they haven't pivoted in any way, I think it is fair and appropriate then to say, what is the expectation for me to be able to find help during this time? And the same goes for your children's schooling. I saw a bunch of questions on there about, like, how do we support school distance schooling right now? How do I motivate my child to even be willing to do it? Or I don't feel like my child's school district is being innovative enough. I will say this, the public schooling in general was not designed to take on distance education in the way that they're being demanded to do right now. So it's going to be a slower change process there. So part of that's an exercise in patience as schools catch up with their limited resources. But if your child is having a really tough time being able to deal with logging into an online classroom system, reach out to your teachers. Those teachers that you trusted your child with for a large portion of the day, every day, are still very, very invested in your kids and wanting to see them succeed. And so if you reach out, more often than not, they will help try to find a solution for your child to motivate them. And if that teacher can't help, go to the other resources in your school. All of your school professionals are still working. They are still employed, and so they are there to help.
So thanks so much for everybody who tuned in and joined us, and hopefully we'll have the opportunity to do something like this again. And thank you again to the Office of Communications for setting this up, and to all the panelists who came and shared their insights.
Thanks for listening. Be sure to subscribe to our podcast and visit us at podcasts.usc.edu.